Welcome to the Lawrence at Home. My name is Fira, and I'm one of the educators from the Lawrence Hall of Science. And welcome to another episode of Stories in STEAM, where we share the stories of scientists as well as the inventions and contributions that they have made. So let's take a look into our story today. All right, so this is a story that we're going to be reading today. It is about Subrahmanyan Chandrasekhar and his many legacies in astrophysics. So let's get into it right away. I'm very excited about this one. So Subrahmanyan Chandrasekhar was an Indian-American astrophysicist. He worked on a variety of physical problems his whole life, from stellar structure and dynamics all the way to quantum theory and relativity. So here we can see that Chandrasekhar is very diverse in what he does, and he's not confined to only one topic or one subject, even within astrophysics. He was the 1983 Nobel Prize in Physics winner, and his calculations contributed greatly to our understanding of stellar evolutions. One of his most profound discoveries was the Chandrasekhar limit. This is interesting. So what exactly is the Chandrasekhar limit? We'll learn about it as we learn more about Chandrasekhar. So let's move on. So Chandrasekhar was born on October 19, 1910 in Lahore, or present-day Punjab, Pakistan. And his intellectual pursuit and curiosity is actually influenced by his own family. And until the age of 12, Chandrasekhar was actually tutored at home. So even though he did not get a formal education, his father still taught him mathematics and physics, while his mother taught him Tamil, which is a language. And his uncle actually was a physicist, and his uncle was actually the 1930 Nobel Prize in Physics winner, C.V. Raman. So truly, they say that sometimes one of your biggest inspirations come from the people closest to you. And in Chandrasekhar's case, it comes from his own family. In 1930, he obtained his bachelor's degree in physics from the Presidency College in Madras. He was then awarded the Government of India scholarship to pursue his graduate studies in the University of Cambridge in the United Kingdom. So even though he started by being homeschooled, he was still able to show his intelligence and his excellence, and he was able to get the opportunity to pursue his education further abroad. And it was actually during his voyage from India to the United Kingdom that Chandrasekhar calculated the Chandrasekhar limit, which is basically the maximum possible mass for white dwarf stars. So a white dwarf is basically a remnant star. It is what stars like our sun will turn into after they get older. Yeah, let's learn more about that. In his first year in Cambridge, he spent his time constructing a model for the limiting mass of degenerate stars. And a white dwarf is a type of degenerate star. And actually, the Astrophysics Friday team have a video about white dwarfs and other stellar remnants coming up soon. So keep an eye out for that. Okay, going back to Chandrasekhar, and in 1933, he received a bronze medal on his work, and he was awarded a PhD degree at Cambridge University. And it was during this time that Chandrasekhar was acquainted with the British physicist Sir Arthur Eddington. And their encounter wasn't necessarily the nicest, and because Eddington publicly ridiculed Chandrasekhar's idea of the limit, and he did so at the Royal Astronomy Society in front of everyone. However, further calculations done by computers proved that Eddington was wrong and proved that Chandrasekhar was right. So in the end, although it took some time, the Chandrasekhar limit was finally accepted, and it was still widely used and applied by astrophysicists to this day. So after that, in 1935, Chandrasekhar was invited to the United States by the director of the Harvard Observatory. And it was during this time when he was in the United States, he was visiting the United States, that he met Gerald Kuiper, Otto Struve, and Robert Hutchins of the University of Chicago's Yerkes Observatory. And when they met him, they were all really, really impressed by him. And it was to the point that Struve invited Chandrasekhar to work at the Yerkes Observatory, and he was also given a praise-filled recommendation by Kuiper. Hutchins also then sent a radiogram to Chandrasekhar, and it was after this that Chandrasekhar finally accepted the offer. So he became an assistant professor of theoretical astrophysics in the University of Chicago. And he stayed at the University of Chicago for the rest of his career, and he became a permanent resident of the United States. And other than his discovery of the Chandrasekhar limit, he also made other contributions to physics and astrophysics. One of them is that he revised the model of stellar dynamics that was first outlined by Jan Oort, a Dutch astronomer. He then extended his analysis to the interstellar medium, showing that gas clouds and dust are not distributed evenly. So here we can see that Chandrasekhar's discoveries did not stop at the limit, and he continued to do plenty of research in other topics and subjects as well. In addition to his limits, a lot of things were also named after Chandrasekhar. In 1979, NASA named the Chandra X-ray Observatory after him. And this is the Chandra X-ray Observatory. It is currently in space and taking pictures in X-ray for us. And then there's also the Chandrasekhar number. They also named an asteroid after him. And it was the asteroid 1958 Chandra. There's also the Himalayan Chandra Telescope in India, which is this one. And there's also the Chandra Astrophysics Institute, or CAI, that was owned by MIT. Now, Chandrasekhar was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1983 for his work on the physical processes that are important to our understanding of the structure and evolution of stars. However, at first, Chandrasekhar was upset because the award only mentioned his earliest work. So it only mentioned his work on white dwarfs and the limit of degenerate stars, but it did not mention any of his other work and discoveries. And at first, Chandrasekhar felt like this award was a denigration to his lifetime's worth of achievements. However, in the end, he still accepted the award, and he shared it with William A. Valor, who also helped him in his research. And Chandrasekhar has plenty of legacies. He published lots of books and around 380 papers in his lifetime. His knowledge and passion are also carried on by the students that he taught and guided, one of them being the famous astronomer Carl Sagan. And Chandrasekhar passed away in 1995, but in 2010, the University of Chicago conducted a symposium that was attended by lots of famous astronomers and astrophysicists and scientists from around the world, and it was called the Chandrasekhar Centennial Symposium 2010 as a tribute to Chandrasekhar's supposed 100th birthday. So here we can see that even though Chandrasekhar is no longer with us, we continue to celebrate and honor him for all his work and his contributions. And with that, we've reached the end of our story time today. And Chandrasekhar is a man who's filled with achievements and greatness, and I hope his story have inspired you as much as it has inspired me. So yeah, that is the end of our story time today. Thank you so much for joining us for our story time, and I hope you stay healthy and safe always. And yeah, make sure to give this video a like and subscribe to the Lawrence Hall of Science YouTube channel to show your support. Once again, thank you so much for watching. Bye, everyone.